Actually, the desertification means where life systems cannot survive, you know, organisms cannot survive, you know, like plants, like trees, animals, birds, insects, and so on. If life cannot survive, that is known as a desert. So there obviously livelihoods would be a big challenge there, and so that's why normally people won't be there.
What are the different kinds of drought?
Yeah, droughts can be classified essentially of two types. One is what we call an agronomical drought. Agronomical drought is where rain-fed crops fail for want of timely rains. See, these rain-fed crops, for which the duration is about 80 to 120 days, they need rain every 15-20 days interval. So, more than the volume of the rainfall, the frequency or the distribution of the rainfall at the rate of 20 millimeters and above is important. So, if you have a rainfall of 20 millimeters or so in every 15-20 days for, you know, 6-7 times, then the rain-fed crops will thrive well. So, then that year is a good year. Supposing, let us say, one or two rains miss in between, regardless of how much more rainfall you get afterwards, but this one or two rains of long dry spell, missing of long dry spell, will kill the crops. So thereby crops have failed, and that is called agronomical drought. Another one popularly known is what is hydrological drought. Hydrological drought is where there is a severe water stress or moisture stress. So that is happens when actually the rainfall doesn't occur in expected volume. Thereby what happens, you will not have the water bodies locally made, like village tanks and streams and check dams and things like that. They won't get filled the water. Once they are not filled, then the groundwater gets affected. Not only that, then the fodder situation also will be affected. So people will have a lot of problem for grazing, for borewell water will be depleted, and then crops cannot be taken under borewells and so on. So drinking water will be a major issue at that time for people and also animals. The water stress affects every part of life and every life system. Be it animals, be it birds, be it insects, everything it affects. Yes. So that is a hydrological drought. So sometimes both of them come together. Sometimes there is a low rainfall and not well distributed, and then also there is no water bodies filled, and thereby both of them come together. That will be worse.
So from what you're telling me, I understand that it's a cycle. Both drought and flood are a cycle. It could be that during El Nino years, the droughts are exacerbated. But again, if there is uneven distribution, then it could be because of climate change. Now, would you try to make a difference between the two? And since this is a chronically drought-prone area, how does is there a pattern to the rainfall, the intensity and the cycles to it?
See, there is always some kind of an established pattern for rainfall. We have a rainy season starting from June till about November. Southwest monsoon comes up to September, and then October and part of November is the northeast monsoon. This is the rainy season. Within this rainy season, there is some kind of a monthly average normal rainfall that occurs, in June so much and July so much, like that. So based on that kind of a normal rainfall, the cropping systems and so on are evolved in these areas. What happens over a period, there is a change in the pattern of rainfall. There is no change. There is a lot of studies done on it, even on Anantapur kind of rainfall. So the studies suggest that volume has not changed. Volume has neither increased nor decreased. But what has changed is rainfall has shifted from, June, July, August to more to summer. Summer means April, May, June months. The rainfall during the April, May, June months are not really useful for rain-fed crops, because rain-fed crops come only during the rainy season, that is June and November. So this dispersion that has taken place has created more what we call agronomical droughts. So the distribution has, number of rainy days have come down, and the intensity of the rainfall has increased. So when the number of rainy days come down, what happens? Then the dry spells become longer. Once the dry spells become longer, then the crops fail more. So that's why actually in government, according to government account, there are about 18 droughts in last 21 years. So agricultural droughts I am talking about. So 18 times crops have failed in last 21 years of different degrees. So this is actually a recent phenomena in last, let us say, 25 years. Earlier to that, there was certainly little better distribution compared to what it is happening now.
So what were the factors that triggered desertification in Ananthapur and in this microclimate or in this region?
See, on one side, there are natural kind of triggers. Natural triggers are like low rainfall, for example. And also here the land, the soils are also not deep. They are also very shallow kind of soils. There is not much forest area. Ananthapur district has got only about 10% of the area under forest, whereas for a viable area you need about 30% of the geographical area as a forest. So we have less forest and so on. So these are some of those natural kind of phenomena. Added to that, what has added to that is the way farming systems have evolved, the way the grazing systems have evolved. So they also added to the desertification process. In last 50-60 years, particularly after the Green Revolution came, market economy took over. When the market economy took over, from subsistence agriculture, now the agriculture has shifted to commercial agriculture. Once the commercial agriculture comes, then you go in for crops that are more cash fetching rather than food security and so on. So thereby what has happened under rain-fed conditions, the cropping pattern from what used to be an audanya multi kind of a cropping system to now a monocrop of groundnut has emerged in last 40 years.
But that's compatible to dry land farming.
I am talking about dry land farming because we have to always distinguish dry land farming from irrigation. Because irrigation, you have an assured irrigation, then you can do lot of things.
The infrastructure is there.
Was it the legislation of the Convention on Biological Diversity after the Rio Summit that led to the declaration of Ananthapur as a pro-desert prone area or desertified area?
Yes, you see, at that time the world kind of awake about the importance of biodiversity, importance of conserving the life systems and biodiversity. So that was the time. Actually, 1993-94 was the year when Ananthapur was declared as desert prone. Is the only district in South India which was declared as desert prone, and that is when actually government also started lots of watershed development kind of activities in order to conserve the soil, rainwater, vegetation and life systems and so on.
And what were these kind of programs or schemes that the government launched?
Within the watershed development program, a number of activities, like for example soil and moisture conservation, contour banding and those kind of activities, and then also rainwater harvesting, rainwater harvesting so that all the rainfall that falls is harvested and then used to improve the groundwater and also for crops and so on. So, and then improving the vegetation, trying to protect the forest, protect also the wastelands and common lands that are there, and put more and more plants there. So thereby biomass is increased, and once the biomass and tree cover is increased, then other living beings like birds, insects and all that, the whole ecology will really develop. So those kind of activities were promoted by the government, and also that was the time when even NGOs also jumped into this kind of work. Then NGOs also contributed for improving the local natural resources.
I think when Ananthapur was declared as desertified or to combat desertification back in 1994, the Andhra Pradesh government collaborated with many NGOs in Ananthapur district, right? Can you give us a perspective about that?
Yes, they prepared one project called Watershed Development Program actually. So that was first time when the government made NGOs as partners in implementation of that program. Because what happened, the government is known for implementing programs with a top-down approach. For them, they think that the officers or technocrats and so on, they know better, and so they go and tell to the people, so we'll do this and so on. And then they do it, and then farmers are not involved, villagers are not involved in that. But in the watershed development, at the, by then already some of the NGOs were already setting some kind of a trend for participatory watershed development. Ourselves, you know, our own organization, Rural Development Trust, was one organization which has gone into participatory watershed development. Anna Hajare Sahab is another one who has gone into participatory watershed development. So from these kind of programs, they took up that as a policy, that it watershed development has to be at the village based, and also it has to be participatory. That is why some new guidelines came in 1994 for watershed development. They are called watershed guidelines for participatory watershed development. They were drafted by one Hanumant Rao, who was a member of the planning commission at that time.
How did desertification manifest in Anantapur for people?
See, desertification manifested by high level of eroded soils, reduced vegetation and biomass, and reduced the wildlife, and reduced birds, reduced kind of insects and so on. These are all, it's an ecology actually, it's an ecology. So the ecology itself came to a very, very low level. Water regime also changed. Water regime has become very low, and then surface water bodies were not getting adequate water. So groundwater depleted, thereby it really created a lot of stress, to the bore wells and things like that. So it is a gradual process. It's not that overnight it has happened, but certainly it has accentuated in last 20, 25 years. We can see it visibly because I have been living here for 68 years, how it has changed.
Between 1983 and 87, there was a very major drought in India triggered by El Nino. Did that exacerbate desertification process here?
See, El Nino effect actually impacts more at the national level. At the district and so on, you cannot see that kind of an impact as a trend. It may happen, but we cannot say, okay, because El Nino effect is there, Anantapur will get, less rain. We cannot say like that. Somewhere else will get less rain.
Yes, unseasonal weather.
At a macro level, it will impact. Mm-hmm. National average will come down, maybe. But Anantapur average will remain, whether El Nino or no El Nino, it may keep fluctuating by itself.
Okay.
Because at a local, the unit is too small for a trend to emerge. Yes, yes.
And will you please describe the hardships that the people faced because of desertification?
See, what happens because of desertification or because of droughts, whichever it is there, because of very, very frequent droughts in last 20 years, there was a severe poverty and indebtedness that has affected. It has affected actually the people, what people consume, and then, their life, living conditions and so on. So the old coping mechanisms all have disappeared, whatever it is now, because of the commercialized agriculture and so on. So the only major coping mechanism is migration. For large numbers, they really migrate to Bangalore, Kerala, other places, and other parts of Karnataka. Chennai also sometime, but Chennai less comparatively, but mostly Karnataka.
Closer
borders for us, and so on. All through there is a rich ecology, Western Ghats run parallel to Anantapur district. So there was, so migration is there. And then also, this also manifests in some kind of, very cheap labor, and also sometimes human trafficking, and then resorting to other crime also to some degree, and then immoral activities.
Social impact.
Yeah, even if 10 out of 1000 start doing this kind of extreme anti-social activities, it will affect the social fabric itself.
That's a deleterious impact. It's a kind of a social pollution.
Yeah, yeah.
Was it possible to map the dry arid zones in a microclimate perspective when it was declared desertified?
It is possible, because though at one level, let us say, Anantapur district has got low rainfall of 553 millimeters, temperatures range between, 15 to 42 and so on. But that is a, within the Anantapur district, there are again sub-agro-climatic zones. Some part of Anantapur district get about 600 millimeters. Some parts within Anantapur get only 350 millimeters. So thereby it creates a lot of difference even within the Anantapur district also. Even village to village also. The village where you have black soils will have a little better moisture holding capacity and better crops. Next village will have red soils and shallow soils, and then you will have more droughts there. So to some degree it affects even village to village also. You know,
microclimate,
yeah.
Terrain, precipitation, all those things matter.
All this matter, yeah, yeah. Precipitation matters. The livelihoods, that is the primary thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What were the plants used for ecological succession? Give me a botanical perspective for watershed management, possible?
Yeah, yeah. Not only for watershed management, it is actually for improving the whole ecology. What is being done by us and also other NGOs and government also is to we have identified the native species which have been grown here for centuries. It's like, for example, tamarind, and you have neem, you have pongamia, you have glaricidia, you have jamun, you have custard apple. They are all native to this kind of place. They survived under this kind of harsh agroclimatic conditions. If we can build our vegetation around these species, then we will be able to really improve the whole ecology, because trees becomes a very important starting fact, kind of activity for improving the ecology. Because you have trees, then automatically birds will come, automatically insects will come. Like that. So I think if we depend on these kind of local native species, we are doing a good job.
Talking about this botanical perspective, maybe was there any growth of cacti or dryland
Cacti has been part of Anantapur landscape for ages.
I see.
Yes,
so
yes,
it
yes.
was there.
It is there.
Moisture retention.
They are moisture. Yeah, they survive under very harsh conditions.
So that was also there. Do you have to plant up acacia species as part of
Yes, as part of farm forestry, we had to wasteland development, we had to do that. Yes.
So to make it fertile.
Yes, yes.
So to what kind of a botanical approach do you need to convert, say, sandy loamy soil in sand dunes to make it fertile alluvial?
See, in sand dunes, what happens in sandy areas, sand will keep shifting for the wind. From here to there, it will become a big, this thing.
Dune.
Sand dune and so on. So it will keep shifting, and it's very difficult to cultivate crops there because it shifts. So normally, what is done for that is that you make plant trees that can go little tall as the wind breaks.
Ah,
so if the
like
wind
casuarina.
Breaks, like casuarina or Nilgiri, eucalyptus and things
Biosheen.
Like that. So then the shunt movement will come down. Then you can do cultivation, that is, crops.
Can you tell me a brief one sentence only on the efficacy of bioshields in, say, sand dune management? Or
that is the only answer that we have. You have to only make barriers at frequency. There is no other way that you can control the sand dunes. It's a naturally, moving because of the wind. So you have to really stabilize them. If you have to stabilize, you have to make wind breaks. If you have to make wind breaks, plant trees.
So, and native trees.
Yes, yes. Native trees only will survive there.
Survive in such conditions.
Yeah.
Okay. Very interesting. And these kind of, like you say, windbreakers and things like that, do they help in catchment area conservation also?
It will help, because in wind erosion is one of the common erosions in particularly low forest areas. Wind erosion really hits the soil, takes away into the wind, and then lands it somewhere
in
the else. Mid-air literally. So I think that's why even in the cropped areas also we do farm forestry. Farm forestry means plant bunds, like pongamia, custard apple and things like that. That will reduce the wind velocity, and then that will,
stabilize the soils
there. And it will also create biomass there, and, lot of leaflet dropping and so on. And it will also have tree cover always, gives a protection to the land. It will not be exposed to the sun. It is very, very important. The most important factor in this is the land should not be directly exposed to sun, wind and rain. Then you can fight the desertification. It is the opposite. If you expose the land to the sun, wind and rain, you are desertifying. If you cover it up, you are regenerating. This is as simple as that. How you do that?
Nutrition.
Soil, under the soil, there are so many microorganisms, we call microbes, within the soil. Soil are microorganisms. They are very important for plant growth. But when we expose them to the sun, we will kill all of them. And then nothing will thrive there. So that is why we need to cover.
And soil erosion of that.
Yes, yes. So we have to keep the soil covered.
So restoration of soil nutrition is critical.
Critical, very critical for crop production.
And that can be done only with biological approach. That's more than enough.
Other approaches you can do, but unsustainable, and then it's very expensive and so on. But there is no substitute. The other approaches are not substitute.
And what are these other approaches?
You can do some plastic mulching nowadays to cover the crops, and that is very hazardous. You mix so much of plastic into the soil, cross soil, you will prevent the soil breathing, and then you will also prevent microbes, thriving there and so on. So these are shortcuts that come from Green Revolution model, which is not really hazardous to the soil.
So when you have done this kind of, watersheds, created watersheds, has it created rewilding? From by wildlife maybe, or zoodiversity, has it commenced after?
Certainly, wherever watershed development is done, and particularly more vegetation has come up, certainly rewilding is happening. You can see now a lot of deers, a lot of wild boar, and a lot of rabbits and things like that. So it is also improving. Overall, Anantapur ecology itself is improving, in the sense vegetation is improving. Once the vegetation increases, it has its own positive effect on other life systems. So it is harboring now these kind of
things. Will it increase rainfall once the vegetation catchment area is enriched?
Well, that is not scientifically proved yet. But what is proved is that it will create the same rainfall will create double the impact on the soil. So moisture retention will be doubled. So it is like you get double the rainfall. So you will, once you have the vegetation, the moisture will be retained in the soil, more number of days. That automatically enhances productivity.
Will you please narrate Akshayam Prachana's story as regards groundwater replenishment?
Yes, I think we have done some excellent work on groundwater replenishment, particularly where in the villages where we have done watershed development. We have almost saturated the villages. Not a drop of water goes out of that village. All the rain that falls is sunk into the lands within the village, because we have made, starting from contour banding where you harvest water, interbund, you harvest rain water and then another bund, then there is a little stream, then you make a smaller check dam, stream is a little bigger, you make a bigger check dam. So these are series of kind of rainwater harvesting work. Then added also farm forestry to that, you plant trees on the bunds, and so that you control the wind erosion, you increase the biomass and vegetation and things like that. Then wherever wastelands are there, we have put in there vegetation. And then more importantly, the big contribution is now we have increased tree crops. So we have changed the land use from annual crops to perennial crops, like tree crops, like particularly mango. In our watershed, mango is a very, very big intervention in watershed development, where you bring in vegetation across the farmed area, so that itself will protect. It's like you are creating some kind of a forest there if you are doing a horticulture with mango.
The trees come.
Its own forest.
Will do the rest.
Yes. So thereby, because of all these kind of measures, groundwater has been really increased like anything. So though groundwater is increasing, but number of bore wells are also going up.
It is unfortunate
because there is a regulation, but that is not seriously taken up for various reasons. There are issues in that, still I think the area under irrigation has maybe increased by three times in watershed areas. Because of watershed interventions, improving the groundwater, improving the tree cover, soil moisture conservation and things like that.
Yes, that I have seen. I have been coming to Anantapur for 20 years now. I have seen a lot of increase in green cover. Give us a stakeholder perspective in groundwater replenishment.
See, the stakeholders are farmers here, basically. The groundwater, given the kind of poverty and insecurity here, and indebtedness and things like that, and also market economy, nowadays the culture is that you have to become rich by the evening, so farmers also get that kind of a mindset, and they like to make use of the groundwater as much as possible and then really grow crops that are really cash, that can bring more cash to them. So that kind of attitude is built in, not not by farmers themselves, but that is what is encouraged. Increase more, grow more food, grow more vegetables, grow more fruit, grow more. So that also helped them and give incentive for this, for that. So all put together, what happened? This over exploitation has come in. That is the stakeholder perspective is now they have really developed their village and they are over exploiting. Now something has to be done now to say okay, let us stop now. So we have a solution for that. We have government also is convinced now that it has to be done. Is the whatever water we get from Tungabhadra and Handriniva, these kind of river projects, we are asking them to fill the tanks, water bodies, village tanks. Once instead of giving flood irrigation in some area, so if they can fill these water bodies within the village, then it will stabilize the groundwater levels. Because now they are not getting filled with rain, they are only getting full once in 10 years. When I was child, they were getting filled alternate years, but now it is once in 10 years. 9 years they are empty. If that water can be put into this water bodies, groundwater will certainly increase. Then the stakeholders will be very happy and then they can really get their, do their agriculture, at least whatever is under irrigation. Rain-fed agriculture also can be improved with this kind of situation because they can provide protective irrigation to rain-fed crops. As I was telling you, if there is one long dry spell, that one irrigation can be added by transporting water. It is possible. We have done it actually in more than 20-25,000 acres we have done and proved it. So if water is available somewhere nearby, you can give life-saving irrigation to the crop. Afterwards, some rains will come, catch up, and then crops will come normally. So that is actually some kind of a holistic solution for Anantapur drought is now filling the water bodies in Anantapur. We call it Ananta Jalavalayam or Anantapur water grid. It will help specially across the district. It will also help poor farmers who are rain-fed farmers to access water from the water body and give protective irrigation to the crops. It will enhance the groundwater and then also give irrigation also, underground, under the bore wells.
And will you picture as the impact of crop loss on the population in Anantapur because of desertification?
See, crop loss is very difficult to say. What is crop loss here is the food crops loss. Food crops are lost. We have resorted to more oil seeds like groundnut. Once you lose the food crops, your food changes. What you eat also changes. So that is the biggest loss for Anantapur district. There is now object poverty in Anantapur district. People are not dying because of starvation. But people are dying because of malnutrition. Because you eat only that is because of the cropping system that we have lost from Anantapur district.
Dr. Reddy, please picturize the impact of lack of water and sanitation on the rural population. I mean, how did desertification manifest on the rural impoverished population?
Yeah, I think lack of water has really affects everybody in the village, particularly of course the poor and also more particularly the women, because the children also. So one thing is that they have to spend a lot of time to wait for the water, because 50% of the Anantapur district villages even now depend on tankered water. In the sense, a tractor will bring some water with a tanker and then the people will have to really take from there. So it comes not really every day, maybe 2-3 times in a week and things like that, and then people have to wait there and they have to give up their work sometime and then wait for the water, and then long queues of pots where it comes and stops and things like that. So it really affects them like anything. It adds to their drudgery and then weight and stress, and then they cannot give time to their children, and then children also
it adds up,
and hygiene also gets affected because you have less water, and then sanitation is almost impossible to maintain. Whatever it is, without water it is very, very difficult. So it creates a real misery.
But is there a political angle to tanker supply of water? Because usually it is a political kara. They intentionally make sure that there is no water supply, and the politicians are, I don't want to embarrass you, but politicians make a heyday when sunshine, so to say.
Not really. I haven't noticed that deliberately making water shortage, but when water shortages are there, when the water has to be tankered, of course, some people take that as an opportunity and then use it. That is fine. But deliberately, I don't think we haven't come across that kind of a situation. So, because people also demand, people also ask.
I mean,
people,
water is essential. It's
essential, yeah. Nowadays, good thing is that people are able to demand. They voice, women particularly, they are able to voice and say, what is this? So,
are there any kind of, you know, awareness, community, radio kind of initiatives for this kind of watershed management for development?
No, we did not try that.
Because many places community radio has succeeded.
I know that.
Traditional communities and all that.
Yes. Some are, NGOs also have done that, yes.
Can you give us an anecdotal perspective of rural malnutrition in Anantapur?
Yes, malnutrition is quite high in Anantapur, particularly among the children and also women, because it is manifest very much now. The women, their HBs are less than 7%, many of them, and they are carrying, and so they come to the hospitals with such bad hemoglobin level, and then the risks are very, very high. So, children are really prone to so many problems when they are malnourished, particularly diarrhea and respiratory infections, and then, all sorts of,
It affects the mental health.
Yeah, mental health also very much. It is all because, of course, the food pattern is now only limited to rice and not really so many, even vegetables also. The culture has developed that you have to eat load of rice, not really vegetables. Leave alone any other ingredients. So I think that is what is the problem. So
it is creating more pandemics.
Yes.
Diabetes and endocrine disorders have become assumed pandemic proportions.
Growth is affected, children's growth, weight is affected, height is affected. So
development and progress is affected.
Yes, naturally.
You said maternal mortality and menstrual hygiene are not the core competency. How did and how does water stress manifest in the daily lives of the people? Give us an anecdotal perspective.
See, water stress affects every part of day, because to start with, you need a water for drinking, for domestic consumption. You need water also for animals. You need also water for agriculture. So I think water is the elixir of life. So I think it really cripples. If you don't have water, then you really don't know what to do with yourself.
Right to life, right to water.
Without right to water, right to life is meaningless. So I think that really affects every part of the day for them. Yeah.
Sir, if in a day and age when there is so much of privatization happening, God forbid if there is commercialization of water supply, because in the day and age of the kind of rampant license raj that we have today, even though we didn't like it, that kind of favored, corrupted few have access to water. Will there be a day and age when there's commercial supply of water in backward areas like Anantapur, or will they not come to backward areas?
See, as I see it, half of it is already commercialized. All drinking water is already commercialized. Whatever government is supplying also, people are not drinking most of the time that water. They are still going for the bottled water. Bottled water industry is thriving because of that. So now they are also trying to privatize even some rivers, then water bodies and so on. I think that is going to really affect human life. And then it will really create such a divide between those who can afford and those who cannot afford.
Right
to life becomes meaningless for poor without right to water, at least for their consumption, if not for agriculture and other things. Yeah.
No, right to water is there for drinking, cooking, bathing, all primary needs.
Yes, primary needs.
Food.
Yeah.
Now we come to a very interesting question, because you've been very critical of rice and wheat, I just noticed. So, did the Green Revolution change cropping patterns from native dryland farming to water-hungry crops like rice?
Yeah, it has changed quite a lot, because prior to grain revolution, the agriculture was also what is known as some kind of a subsistence agriculture. Subsistence agriculture is where essentially people grow food for consumption of their own and also their own nearby towns, and at that time very small towns were also there. So green revolution came in. Along with green revolution also came in commercialization of agriculture. That is actually having double effect. In the sense green revolution is very high, I call it green revolution, high external input destructive agriculture. This is called HIDA. This is opposite to another pattern called low external input sustainable agriculture, which we used to have and before green revolution. Added to that, the market economy. Market economy drives everyone for cash. They want to become rich by the evening and do what you like and so on. So then both together, what has happened? Subsistence agriculture has totally disappeared. And now they grow crops only what bring them money. And that is also, you know, very highly patriarchal. All money only goes to men. And you know, food is the business of women, but they really don't have any control over that. So monocrop has emerged because of this kind of cash driven green revolution model, high external input paradigm. So because of that monocrop, what happened? This kind of a paradigm which is driving people to markets and cash killed the food crops, food diversity, native food also. So now at the same time also another coincidence that has happened that has worsened the situation was the rice was given at a very subsidized rice in Andhra Pradesh in 1983 onwards and so 1 rupee or 2 rupees case, 2 rupees acre first. So along with rice, if they had to give all other food grains also, that would have been better. But they stuck to food because rice lobby is very strong all over the country. Rice lobby is very strong, so they zeroed in on rice in South India and wheat in mostly wheat in North India. And all agricultural research under green revolution model also focused on only few crops. Like rice, like wheat, like mulberry, like sugarcane, like 5, 6, 7 types. And we had hundreds of varieties of other crops which are neglected. Even I wonder even if there is a germplasm remaining of those kind of things nowadays. Such is the kind of genetic destruction that has happened.
You were talking of traditional foodstuffs or cropping. Just give us an idea of what was traditional cropping.
See, traditional cropping here has been a mixed crop. Even one farmer has got 1 acre of land, within that 1 acre, that farmer will raise at least 7-8 types of crops. There are pulses in that and also millets. Millets are generally short duration. Pulses like red gram take little longer duration. So that is some kind of an insurance against drought. When you have 6-7 crops in a 1 acre, that acts as an inbuilt insurance against drought, because some crops fail because of low rainfall, other crops thrive. Some crops are duration of up to 140-150 days, some of them are only 90 days 80 days. Sometimes the 90 days crops fail but long duration crops thrive. Sometimes long duration crops fail, the short duration crops work. So you never have a total failure of crops. But when you have monocrop of groundnut, it is all eggs in one basket. The groundnut either fails or success. So then,
is it a big commercial success, groundnut?
It used to be a very commercially successful, but not now because the yields have really come down. Rain pattern has changed and now it is not really yielding anything.
Has millet cultivation and consumption impacted public health, with special reference to reproductive health and mental health of women in rural
Anandapur? I think it has affected every part of the district, and particularly the rural areas. We see even now rural areas, for example, diabetes, and you see malnutrition, a level of malnutrition, and also problems like cancer emerging in even villages. So all these so-called lifestyle diseases are emerging even in the villages. The lifestyle means more food kind, food what you eat.
That's
you know, that is affecting certainly, and particularly children, elderly people, and women are most, you know, affected. Yeah.
How did Acción Fraterna Ecology Center involve people or people's participation or citizens' participation in watershed management?
See, as I was telling you earlier, this watershed management, we started with participatory approach actually, because this government typical approach is top-down approach, where technocrats or bureaucrats go and tell to people what is good for them,
so
and then
experts.
Experts then tell them and then expect them to listen. But what we did was our philosophy always has been to build on what they know and to build on what they have. This has been our philosophy. So we went, sat with them and spoke to them, understood what are their strengths and what are their issues, what are their problems, what are their opportunities. See, that way you will try to build up, you know, based on people's understanding and awareness from grassroots, a kind of a bottom-up approach. But at the same time, some scientific background has to be given, scientific knowledge also has to be. So we have to really merge both of them. Converge with or marry in a way both of them, and then come to a kind of local specific farmer, sometimes even farmer specific kind of solutions even within the watershed development. So that way actually it has helped them to participate meaningfully, not for the sake of participation, but they are willing to participate in planning what we do on their own farm, and take his ideas, her ideas into account, and then give what is science and then build on that. So we call it net planning. Net planning is planning for every holding. Without the farmer, you cannot do that. So we involve them in decision making, what has to be done. We involve them in planning specifically on where the bund has to go, where the water body has to go, and so on. So we involve them in implementation of those kind of activities, and also monitoring. So what benefit has come? Okay, you did all that work. What benefit has come? Has it improved the groundwater? Has it improved the yields? And so I think that way it is what we call it PIME, planning, implementation, monitoring, and evaluation. At every stage, we involve people. We form their associations or their committees or whatever it is. They participate as representatives to take decisions that are on commons and, you know, generally for the village. But other times, each farmer will have to participate in what they do, in their own form.
What are the livelihoods that are linked to watershed management? Is there any kind of inland fisheries?
Inland fisheries also to some degree is there, but you have to have water bodies for that level. That happens very rarely given the rainfall, once in 10 years or twice in 10 years, like that. But the horticulture, particularly growing tree, fruits and vegetables is directly dependent on that. Pastures, grazing population like livestock and so on, very much directly linked to the watershed development. Vegetation and also the pests and diseases that come. If you have a rich biodiversity, then there is a natural control of pests and diseases. Disease buildup will be low and so on. So then even if the disease is there, but it will not cross the threshold level and damage the crops and things like that. So you need a kind of an ecosystem for agriculture to be sustainable and so on. So that gets destroyed, when we resort to, monocropping.
So looking back at the need for watershed management, what were the initial priorities? Give us a step-by-step perspective, one after the other.
See, what we do is watershed development typically follows what we call a ridge to valley approach. In the sense where from high elevation to valley, we have to take up a series of measures. So to start with, we have to do what we call contour banding, for soil conservation, essentially. So in each form, you have to make a series of bunds across the slope, along the contours or whatever, so that the runoff is reduced, soil erosion is reduced, water is harvested at intervals, and so on. That is one fundamental measure in watershed development. The second thing is, there is some excess water that flows out of the bunds. There are some excess surplus waves that are left out. So when we go little downstream, midstream, then it becomes a stream. So then you have to build some kind of a water harvesting structure there, a check dam. So you build that kind of a check dam there. And then there is some uncultivated, some kind of a hillock at the ridge then you plant trees there, you do trenching work there, you know, so that you harvest the rainwater then and there, and then sinks into the ground and plant the trees there. So you have to want, you know, from ridge to valley, appropriate measures at every level. Gradually what happens, the upper areas also harvest water, the water regime also changes, groundwater improves, water regime goes up also. Now without watershed development, the groundwater is only in the valley area. But if you do proper watershed development, it shifts from valley area to mid valley also, you know. So the middle level farmers also will benefit, higher level farmers also will benefit. Then we have agronomical interventions. Agronomical interventions are where you do some dry land practices to harvest more rain for the crop actually. You know, you do, for example, sowing across the slope is one important measure. Then you do some kind of a dead furrow at every 10 or 15 feet. Dead furrow means a deep furrow across the slope. When it rains and small rain runoff starts, then that deep furrow will harvest like that. Then you also grow crops, intercrops, little deep rooted one row crop. So deep rooted also, the moisture regime is retained within the soil also like that. So there are some agronomical practices which follow. There are series of measures that we can do under watershed development. Can you hear? Is it?
I can, yeah.
Regarding, everything is in order.
And looking back at the need for watershed management, what were the initial priorities? Was it first livelihoods at stake, or agroforestry, or soil conservation? What sector was
the priority? Is soil conservation actually is very, very important, because soil is exposed to rain, wind, and sun. So that is what we have to start arresting. So I think we have to arrest the soil erosion
first,
and then that is where the fundamental measure. Then the rain, harvest rainwater, then improve the vegetation, and then improve the cropped areas, then improve the the horticulture, agriculture, tree crops. Simultaneously, we can do all that, but priority wise, I think without proper soil conservation, it is not worth calling watershed development, particularly in low rainfall areas like Anantapur.
Were the citizens receptive to watershed projects, or were they struggling to adapt to the hard work that watershed management involves? It calls for a lot of discipline, for example, hard work.
Initially farmers were wondering why these people are asking us to participate, what are we to do, they can do and go, because that is what they are used to.
They top down
kind of an approach. Some engineer comes and builds a check dam and goes, and some soil conservation officer comes and makes a check, soil conservation bonds and goes. So then we had to sit with them and discuss with them, understand, help them to be aware of what are the watershed activities and why are they, and so on. So if we generate that kind of awareness and then we want them to participate, certainly they were very happy to participate actually. You create one village with participatory watershed development, then the next village, for this village becomes a model for the next village like that. Actually, over a period of about 5-10 years, it has become a demand driven program. So people from the villages were demanding the government and NGOs, please come and implement watershed development program. We will also participate. Not only we will participate, we will also contribute part of cost also. So it came to that level actually.
Stakeholder, little.
Yes, little is it. Yes, yes.
Okay, now this is a bit of a long question. We'll have to take it segment wise. What were the initial struggles to create watersheds? Please describe various stages of watershed development. Identification of hydrological map.
But I we answered all that actually.
Nursery creation, no, you haven't
answered. No, various stages. I said we start with soil conservation.
No, but I'm talking about watershed management itself. Nursery creation, identification of hydrological map, restoration of soil nutrition, catchment area conservation. Water drainage, awareness creation about wood loss, advantages, and so on.
No, we. We did all that Malini.
Okay.
It is there, it is there. It is only repetition actually.
Okay. How does MNREGA help in rural community assets creation?
Well, MNREGA has certainly helped. That came as a very big opportunity for Anantapur district, because lot of watershed related works have been taken up under MNREGA. Though they are not done in an integrated manner all at a time, in a very systematic manner, but they themselves, even when they are done in independently also, it has its positive impact and so on. So, and also another important policy of the government was there was a watershed development program implemented by central government and state governments, where NREGA funds also can be used. So, thereby actually under the watershed development programs, a lot of NREGA funds were used for watershed development activities. We actually used more watershed, less watershed funds and more actually NREGA funds, because we can implement these activities under NREGA.
It also has a very rich anthropogenic perspective.
Yes, certainly it has. It does have. So, and also these are more farmer centric programs also. For example, one very very good program in Anantapur done by under MG NREGA is the horticulture program. So it is funded totally by MG NREGA. So rain-fed farmers can go for tree crops. They were provided support from starting from pitting to plants to watering also for 3 years and so on. So I think the land use also has changed because of that. More than 50,000 acres has come now under mango, which the government has taken. Yes, yes, yes. So I think lot of good work is done. There are issues in that, but we cannot really throw the baby with the bathwater.
And the objective remains exceptionally good, and also the
objective objective is to create employment on one side, create assets on the other side. There are some issues, because sometimes you know, the employment is stopped midway, and then half the work is done, half the rest of the work is not done, like that. But they take up again next year, it's okay. But still, I think by and large it is.
Because bigger. It depends on seasons maybe.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Because mostly employment is needed in the summers.
Mm-hmm.
Because that is the lean season. Agriculture is not really giving any employment.
Did livelihood security matter to effective watershed management?
One of the objectives of watershed development is to enhance the livelihood security, in the sense that you have to really make viable rain-fed farming and irrigation farming more and more productive, and then pastures to be more with fodder, so that the pastoral population like sheep growers and you know, dairy farmers and so on will get. So it has to in a way you know, rehabilitate the
ecosystem
so that the livelihoods are really harbored within the village. So I think it affects. Employment also gets affected. If you have more irrigation, then more farm employment is there. It's only rain-fed agriculture cannot generate that kind of an employment.
That's true. Tell us about the various strategies deployed for stakeholder efficacy.
Yeah, stakeholder, we train them. We basically train them in what is being planned. It's not so much of technical, but it's more on practical kind of aspects. They also understand, you see, people have got some kind of a traditional wisdom in them. Traditional wisdom also has got some scientific you know, reasoning and things like that. It's not to say that everything is useless. It's not true. It has its size. So that's why there is not really, we have to talk to them in their language. They understand very well. We never came across any village where people did not understand what we are talking. There may be sometimes what they did not agree with us. But it was not that, because they did not understand. For other reasons, Anantapur is a hard area, factions, groups and so on. So sometimes they come into it, But afterwards they realize, and then all over this thing is useless, we better cooperate and then get our work done.
Talking of various factions, was there a Naxal element, or how much was the Naxal factor, relevant in watershed management?
Not really. See, Naxal factor was there, and there was Anantapur was one of the hotbeds of Naxal movement in 80s and also early 90s as such. But they never interfered in these kind of activities. They interfered more on land related ownership issues and things like that and so on. But when we were doing watershed development, they were in a way empathetic with us and But what came in the way sometimes was groups in the villages, factions in the villages and things like that. But we overcome them also. We told them, and you can fight if you want outside, but this is for the whole village. If you are really sensible, you cooperate here. You know, then they all cooperated actually.
That calls for true leadership. It's not easy to do that.
You need to have credibility. They need to understand our intentions are right, and our, you know, I think that is possible. Yes. We did some watershed development work in most faction ridden villages, and where we made both the parties sit next to each other. So this is possible.
But it calls for effective leadership.
It calls for leadership, communication, helping them to understand.
And empathy.
Yes.
What are the different agencies involved in watershed management? It could be.
See, one main actor is the government by itself. The other one is lots of NGOs are involved in this. NGOs have done work with the funds from the government, and also they themselves mobilized, you know, a lot of funds from foreign funds also, national funds also are mobilized. The other important thing, you know, are the stakeholders associations, watershed associations and watershed committees and things like that. So they also participated. It is there was convergence, there was also communication, there was also coordination. Though we were not duplicating anywhere. Government goes and does there, and afterwards we go and do there, or we do something there, government comes and do. It did not happen like that. There was some kind of a coordination. There always we had good relationship and coordination between non-governmental organizations and government. Particularly because of here drought proneness and desert and things like that, that kind of relationship existed. It exists even now,
Describe the ecological succession in an agrobotanical perspective, if you can, otherwise I can interview some
agrobotanicals. Yeah, and I was telling you, ecology is a system, you understand that, living beings, interacts, so on. So, but for them, the starting point is actually trees, I tell you. Trees, what trees is the main question that in ecological succession. What trees are, the simple answer is that native trees. What trees have survived here for centuries, they are the best made for this
ecosystem.
So you start with them, and then other things will start falling in place, and then rainwater harvesting, soil conservation, and all that things will be added along with that. I think that is how we can really create an ecology here.
But what about grasses, starting
with grasses? So there are areas where you can start with grasses, there are areas where you can start with trees, there are
water yielding species.
That is why it is site specific. Mm-hmm.
Can desertification be combated in other areas of the world too? Because in today's day and age of climate change, we had a summit recently in Delhi, Noida, 2 years ago, where they said desertification has overwhelmed ecosystems in southern Sudan, South America, Central Asia, Turkmenistan. Their sandstorms have increased, for example, in the Middle East, and this kind of thing. How can these be addressed?
There are a number of places where desertified lands have been made green, and particularly the starting with the grass cover, improving the grass cover, and then protecting the soil from there onwards and so on. But it is challenging. It is highly challenging. Instead, what we have to do is we have to prevent desertification as much as possible, because there are many areas even within India itself. 40% of the area can be said that it is on the way to desertification. So if we can prevent it, we are doing a very good job, and in the areas where there is already desert, like Thar desert and things like that in Rajasthan and so on, there you can supplement water. Now some of those desert areas, they are doing very well because Indira canal comes to them and their areas are become rich.
That's not sustainable, that's artificial human.
Yeah, but still that is nowadays
it is
that
is. Near term it is helping.
Yeah, it is helping certain things. So people have to live there. So somewhere whatever it is, whatever can be done like that. So,
in some places, like I think this is taking on the previous question itself, because in the day and age of climate change, places like Tajikistan, Turkmenistan in Central Asia, they're suffering from severe sandstorms. And it's cold desert problems there, and even in Ladakh, maybe some parts of Tibet, some those kind of Central Asia, Kazakhstan, extreme western, northwestern China, that's in Central Asia, but also in many parts of sub-Saharan Africa, southern South America, etc. This is how it needs to. Will there be lessons to, that can be shared from, say, Anandapur in these places?
I think these approaches are known all over the world. We don't say that we have done really anything entirely new, but everything has to be fit into the context. You cannot copy and then do it there. You have to fit, your concept has to be fit into the local context. Then only it will work. Otherwise, it will again become, you know,
top-down
approach, and then you do irrelevant things there and then say it is not working and things like that. So, I think local wisdom has to be captured, and it has to be built on the local wisdom. You cannot do entirely different thing and then create a new world in this place.
So would you agree that with some environmentalists and conservationists who say that you have to protect a local ecosystem the way it is, even if it's a desert ecosystem? Would you agree?
See, if it is there is an ecosystem, we should protect it from deteriorating, at least to start with.
Yes.
You know. But livelihoods have to be protected. So whatever it takes, to protect the livelihoods of the people there, and whatever it takes to really prevent worsening the situation, I think has to be done. Otherwise, they will spread. You know,
yes, desertification
yeah. will spread.
In your view, is desertification a result of climate change, or is Anandapur chronically drought prone, regardless of climate change?
No, Anandapur has been chronically drought prone. Well, at least we know for 1500, 2000 years there, the droughts have been there here. But they were not this intense and this frequent. And thereby actually, because the droughts were there, they built coping systems, coping mechanisms. And they were inbuilt, and so thereby, I will explain you a concept. There is a drought and there is also a famine. For Anandapur, for example, is a very popular drought, and famine were very popular. Drought is when one crop fails, then all your food crops have failed. Then, but what happened at that time? Even if there are food crops failed for 1 year, there was enough food available for next year also, because it was a subsistence agriculture. Food was stored. Even labor had enough food for 1 year to stock, for them. But what happened when the droughts came in succession? Second year also there was a drought. Then there is no food anywhere. Then that is called famine. Famine literally meaning food shortage. So that is when the famine code came in, and then all sorts of other relief programs and so on. So there were mechanisms to cope with drought. Drought was seen. Drought was factored in. There were mechanisms that were built in. Farming system was integrated. You had a small farm, rain-fed agriculture. You had livestock in every family. 10, 15, 20 of them were there, and you had also some 4 or 5 mango trees or 4 or 5 tamarind trees around it built and so on. There were commons, grazing areas were there. So like that, it was all integrated. Even if the crops have failed, you have a little uncomfort, but still you can manage and so on. But now what happened, this agriculture in this green revolution paradigm is disintegrated. Agriculture is different, floriculture is different, horticulture is different, fruit cultivation is different. So you have really, and then people don't do all of them, they only do one of them or two of them. So then again the same risk comes in of all eggs in one basket. So that's why that is where actually the coping mechanisms have been destroyed. That is where this green revolution has really disintegrated the coping mechanisms and the ancient systems of coping with drought and things like that. Vulnerability has increased. And you are asking climate change, but that question you can put directly, what are the impacts of climate change?
I'll come back, there are 2-3 more questions left.
You can take your tea before it becomes cold. Voice is okay?
In your view, Dr. Reddy, Is desertification a result of climate change, or is Anantapur chronically drought prone regardless of climate change?
Yes, Anantapur has been chronically drought prone regardless of climate change. But certainly climate change has accentuated the desertification process in last 20-25 years, which is visibly seen here, and also there is enough evidence to show that there is rainfall is shifting, number of rainy days are coming down, and then dispersion is taking place, because of the long dry spells. The dry spells have increased now, so that's why lot more agricultural droughts are happening now. So actually in last 21 years there are only something like 18 droughts, and only 3 crops recorded. This is government record. So every year Anantapur district is declared as drought like that. So this is because of the very sudden kind of a climate change that is happening. I think that is very strongly manifest in on Anantapur district, rainfall particularly, and temperatures also actually.
Describe water stress in Anantapur and how it affected the human landscape. This is very interesting.
But drinking water and like sanitation, we said already that.
Apart from that, isn't there any lack of moisture stress on irrigation?
That's what we told. No, we discussed about that also, irrigation. Okay. Yeah.
Now, human development index, don't get angry. Human development index before and after watershed management success or completion.
It's very difficult to measure human development index at such a micro level, but one can see visibly, one can see change. Standard of living is coming up, and then they are really acquiring more and more consumer goods and things like that. We can see the change in their lives. Education has really become important now, and so everybody is interested in sending their children to schools. Health is prioritized. Even women's health is also prioritized nowadays more.
Right. And apart from watershed, you are a rural development NGO. Do you have other kind of interventions like rural health interventions or anything for?
No, actually we are specialized in watershed development and rain-fed agriculture, not even agriculture and irrigation. So my personal passion has been to see rain-fed agriculture is viable. How we can make it viable? This is the question that I am trying to pursue. So
yours is restricted to rainfed agriculture and watershed management. Okay, now you give me a very detailed perspective on agroforestry and fruit orchard, because that's an extremely interesting experiment. Please talk about livelihood creation, sustainable malnutrition mitigation, food security, fodder, employment opportunities, or livelihood security, and all these aspects of agroforestry or fruit or in the fruit orchard context.
See, generally what happens, horticulture or fruit trees means they think it is under irrigation only it is done, it has to be done. But my life experience and my family experience tells me that it is possible to do agroforestry under rain-fed conditions. Agroforestry, I am meaning growing trees under rain-fed conditions that are for livelihood, that is what is the meaning of that, particularly fruit trees and so on. So what we did was we introduced a concept called rain-fed horticulture. Rain-fed horticulture is not normally understood by those people who go for irrigation agriculture, because they have to irrigate water every 5 days, every 6 days, and then blah blah, all this kind. So, but what we wanted to do was, as one of the important drought mitigation measures, we wanted to introduce this concept of rain-fed agriculture, which is in other words also can be called an agroforestry. So, what we have done is, we have tried to locate which are the fruit trees that can thrive under rain-fed conditions. For example, tamarind, mango, there are other ones like jamun and custard apple, and there is a variety of kind of fruit that can grow under rain-fed conditions. But we actually, after a lot of consultation with farmers, we zeroed in on mango, because they were all fascinated about mango. Nobody likes to grow sitafal as an orchard and otherwise. Yeah, king of fruit, and also it adds to their status and social, self-respect and
income
things like
also.
income also, that automatically some income also, and they are reasonably drought tolerant. Even if you miss one or two or three rains, it can still, trees will survive, trees will yield still, and so on. So that's why we introduced this concept in actually late 90s. We introduced this concept where under rain fed conditions the fruit trees can be grown, you know. So and then in order to make them survive, what we did was we tried to provide them some supplementary watering in the beginning when we plant them, so that they establish. Once they establish, let us say for 3 summers, then mangoes can survive under rain-fed conditions. There is no problem. We can see number of mango trees where irrigation is not given. They are big, maybe they are there for 70 years, 80 years. My own family had a mango garden under rain-fed when I was a child. There was no irrigation there. It was under rain-fed conditions. So that gave me an insight. This can be done elsewhere. So we encouraged farmers, and farmers struggled to irrigate them, that supplementary irrigation, when in the summer when they have to really make them survive. They carried the water on donkeys, they carried the water on bicycles, and on bullock carts and drums and things like that, and gave minimum amount of water so that they don't die until the next rainy season starts. And they survived. Once they survived for 3 years, then they will really be able to be on their own, thrive on their own. They will not flourish. The growth will be different if you are giving every week an irrigation compared to what you give only some supplementary irrigation to establish. But still, they really mitigate the drought because they still give yields, not the highest yields under compared to irrigation, but under rain-fed conditions. They are still viable compared to other rain-fed crops, like for example groundnut, for example, or any other crop that they can grow, red gram and things like that. So we promoted this kind of horticulture. Of course, it was a hard work with farmers. Very difficult because of the long gestation period involved before they see the mangoes, and the kind of hard work involved. Because of the hard work that is involved in horticulture plantation, looking after and so on. So we convinced somehow some of them, and then after seeing some of them, more people came. I think in the end, maybe in last 20 years or so, we may have done about 15,000 acres like that. That is a very big change.
And what are these fruit orchards?
Mango.
Mango.
Mainly mango. There may be one or two other types like jamun and so on, but tamarind and so on. But farmers preferred mango. I was not really convinced about it, but we had to make the farmers
happy.
They are stakeholders after.
But then there is a danger of monocropping again.
There is a danger of monocropping. That's why they are not contiguous. Luckily, they are
scattered
here and there.
Okay.
So that there's a big risk if it becomes a monocrop.
What are the advantages of agroforestry?
We have now revived. We have now, from that actually, we have gone one step forward. Now actually, what we call it is agroecology. The agroecology is now where a cropping system is designed that you have 360 days green cover on the soil, and 360 days there are crops standing on that. So this is an integration of annual crops and also perennial crops. And there are 5 types of tree crops we introduce, different sizes in layered manner. At the periphery we keep big trees, and afterwards you keep little less big trees.
Seasonally you grow it after.
Yeah, and then every 2 months or so then some fruit tree or the other is giving you yield. And then we also grow in between the rows, we also help them to grow rain fed crops like maybe groundnut, maybe red gram, maybe whatever other. So like that, fully form is converted into a kind of a forest.
Red gram means masoor
dal. Red gram is a pigeon pea, call it. Commonly used for dal.
Yes.
For cooking dal. Yes. This is very popular.
Chana dal. Chana.
Chana is different. Chana is
different, but chana dal, uska dicotyl is
different. Yeah.
Uska
yeah.
Half
yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
pigeon pea, okay.
Yeah.
We call it different names. The local names vary.
Local names. So this agroecology is now we have done in one village actually, saturated one village about 300 acres of their land. It's a small village, and where we converted the whole village into a kind of a forest with these kind of trees. They are still growing. This is only a third year, but you can see a change. You can see the agro biodiversity, very rich agro biodiversity, and everything is done without any chemicals being used.
Okay.
It's all totally naturally
organic
farming, you know. And rain-fed crops are also yielding better because land is covered most part of the year without exposing to sun and rain and things like that. So we call this kind of an approach an agroecology, essentially meaning that this kind of approach regenerates the agriculture ecology, regenerates the soil and microbes and biodiversity,
restores the soil nutrition.
You will see an entire kind of change. So this is what we are now actually wanting to replicate, this kind of a model. We are lobbying also with government. There are some agencies which are involved. It's an emerging concept. There are very eminent scientists who have come and validated this kind of an approach, which is very good for and highly suitable for this kind of area. And the kind of natural farming, low external input, farmer made inputs, kind of natural farming is also very much appreciated, you know, because it is low cost and local materials only used, like cow dung, cow urine, and then organic farming also sometimes can be expensive, but this one is very, very low cost. Traditional organic farming sometimes can be, you have to go for earthworms, you have to go different composting and all that. This is we use inoculants to create soil biotic life, much more richer, like that. This is now agroforestry. We call it now more agroecology. Because of that, so we are now looking for it is also a very direct answer to the climate change. It will really harvest lot of carbon. It's called carbon sequestration. It will sequester carbon in the tree canopy and also at the root zone and so on, things like that. And it will prevent droughts. Certainly it is a big measure to really prevent droughts. You answer the drought, you answer the livelihood, you answer the climate change, and you will see the ecology and so on. So it's a multiple kind of
livelihood. Please tell me about this. There was a very unique concept called pond drip irrigation, which apparently has now been abandoned in favor of sprinkler irrigation. Please tell me about pond drip irrigation, and then you tell me why it's being.
We tried it in 80s and early 90s, actually for tree plants, particularly for mango and so on. But maintenance issues were there, and you have to transport water for every pot and keep filling and so on. So farmers found it very difficult, very arduous for them to do that kind of a work. But meanwhile, technology has come and taken over now. Now instead of pot drip, now there is a drip micro irrigation. Not sprinkler. Sprinkler is slightly different, but drip irrigation is where you just pull a small pipe, and then wherever it is needed, you make a hole, and then it will start irrigating there. There is established micro irrigation kind of systems now. It doesn't really require, and it is not expensive nowadays, because the pot drip will become more expensive nowadays compared to this.
Because so then the pot drip irrigation creates livelihood opportunities for women.
True, but it is very highly labor intensive. Nowadays labor is a big issue. There are other things that women can do which are much more productive than this.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay. So thanks very much, Dr. Reddy. Thank you so much for a very detailed interview. Thank you for giving us the time for this. I hope I can do justice by visualizing all your answers.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you so much.